Good morning. This is Dr. Deepak Natarajan, Director of Cardiology, Supreme Hospital, Delhi NCR. We all know because of large randomized studies comparing a NOAC, that is either rivaroxaban, apixaban, or edoxaban, are causing less cerebral hemorrhage when compared to a vitamin K antagonist in patients of non-valvular atrial fibrillation. We also know that they are non-inferior where ischemic stroke is concerned when compared to a vitamin K antagonist such as warfarin. However, there is very little data in patients of rheumatic heart disease with atrial fibrillation. We now have a large study, finally, which was presented last month in Barcelona and also published in the New England Journal of Medicine. This is the Invictus trial. This included 4,500 patients, a little bit more, of rheumatic heart disease with atrial fibrillation. This was a randomized, non-inferiority, open-label study. The second author is Professor Karthik Karthikeyan from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. The study is very good, especially because we have a pretty big burden of rheumatic heart disease still in India. The study was done across the planet in 24 countries, I think in 130 centers. 70% of the people, the patients recruited were women. The CHADS VAS score was 2 or more. The mitral valve area had to be less than 2 centimeters square. The other two criteria for inclusion were the presence of a thrombus in the left atrium or the presence of contrast echo in the left atrium. Now, these patients were randomized either to a dose, single dose of rivaroxaban of 20 milligrams in a day, or to a vitamin K antagonist where the INR ratio was maintained between 2 and 3. When the study began, the therapeutic range in the vitamin K antagonist was seen in 33%. However, by the end of the study, which was about 3.1 years, the INR ratio was being maintained by 65% of the patients. Now, the other important thing is that about 85% of the patients had moderate to severe mitral stenosis. Severe mitral stenosis was defined as a mitral valve area of less than 1 centimeter square. And the results were a bit surprising. At the end of 3.1 years, it was found that rivaroxaban caused a 25% increase in the composite endpoint of stroke, systemic embolism, myocardial infarction, or cardiovascular death. Now, this was very surprising because it was presumed that both would fare equally well. But here we are finding that the clinical outcome was worse in the rivaroxaban group, and this was largely driven by deaths. Deaths were much more in the rivaroxaban group. Now, the average age of these patients was about 50 years. Now, the take-home message from this study is that if you have a patient of rheumatic heart disease with atrial fibrillation and the valve area is mitral valve area is less than 2 centimeters square, it is best to use a vitamin K antagonist such as warfarin or acitromycin, which are cheap, but of course, which mandate the checking of the INR at least once a month. There are some gaps in this study. But before that, of course, I have to congratulate the researchers. This must have been a difficult task to do such a big study in a low and middle income countries across the planet. However, the gaps are that the dropout rate in the rivaroxaban group was pretty high. That was about 22% versus 6.5% in the vitamin K antagonist group. The other gap is that obviously, and this is conceded by the authors, that the vitamin KA cohort was more closely looked after. The care was better because they had to be seen at least once a month to check the INR. So there's a very good possibility that if there were risk factors in these people, remember, the average age is 50 years, so they could be having diabetes, they may be having hypertension, or they may be having other ailments, and these could have been looked better by the healthcare providers or by the doctors looking after them, as opposed to the rivaroxaban group, which did not demand such attention. The third gap would be that we are talking only about rivaroxaban. I don't think we can generalize this data to the other NOACs such as apixaban or edoxaban. The fourth gap is that the authors very conveniently ignore the fact that this study has been done during the COVID pandemic. It is imperative that we know what are the numbers of COVID deaths in these people and also whether there was any significant mortality post-vaccination. I of course agree that these are poorer countries, so the vaccination uptake must have been very low, but yet, and also in these countries, I doubt if the messenger RNA vaccines were given, but yet I would like to know whether there was mortality because of COVID or whether there was, what were the numbers of deaths post-vaccination. So these would be the gaps in the study. At the end, of course, I once again congratulate the researchers, especially Professor Karthikeyan of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Delhi. Apart from that, of course, the take-home message is very clear that if there is a patient of rheumatic heart disease with atrial fibrillation, the drug of choice as things stand, as per information available to us, would be a warfarin. And one must try, of course, to maintain the INR ratio between 2 and 3. Thank you very much for listening to this talk.